Bret Stephens is here. He is an opinion columnist for the New York Times. Earlier, he was an opinion columnist for the Wall Street Journal and deputy editor of the editorial page. As a young man, he was the editor of the Jerusalem Post, graduated from the University of Chicago and also the London School of Economics. He received a Pulitzer Prize in 2013. We want to talk about war and politics, war in Ukraine, war in the Middle East. I think it was Clausewitz who said, war is nothing but the continuation of politics with other means. I'm pleased to have Bret Stephens here. Let me begin by talking about politics. Characterize what has happened in America and American politics since the attempted assassination of former President Trump.
I think I'm hard-pressed to think, Charlie, of a more unpredictable and tumultuous period in American political life. I guess my lifetime includes the end of Richard Nixon's presidency, but I don't exactly have a vivid memory of it. What we've had is a complete revolution of assumptions, maybe multiple revolutions. Assumption one, Joe Biden was going to be the candidate for better or worse for the Democratic Party. I had been saying for several years it would be for worse and that he was not physically capable of carrying a campaign to a successful conclusion. Then the guy who had been written off 2 years ago after the midterms, Donald Trump, seemed like an inevitable candidate, most of all after the assassination. And then at that moment, Trump's fortunes fell in a way that nobody predicted. Kamala Harris's fortunes rose in a way that I certainly didn't predict. We now have an election that I think is impossible to predict. The reason I'm struggling for an answer, Charlie, is that when assumptions spin at this rate, it's very difficult to know where we're going to be in a week's time. I mean, I was just looking back just before we got on this call on some of my columns from the last month or so. And it's just kind of astonishing to think about how much has happened in American politics since then. But certainly if you'd asked me a month ago who was going to be president in a year's time, I would have said almost certainly Donald Trump. If you'd asked me if Kamala Harris had the political talent to run a successful campaign, I would have said no. So maybe that just shows you what I know.
Do you now believe?
Which isn't a lot.
Do you now believe she has the political talent to run a campaign?
I think she's a politically disciplined candidate. The contests that would have exposed her weakness, that is to say, a primary contest against other Democrats, that was completely avoided by the way in which this process unfolded. So as the Democratic nominee, she has a much larger, more talented, more richly resourced campaign operation. She has clearly learned in office. She's a much better candidate. The candidate we've seen the last couple of weeks, 3 weeks, has been a much better candidate than the one we saw 5 years ago when she ran in 2019, didn't even make it to Iowa. And she's running against an opponent who is apparently incapable of any sort of political discipline. So all of those are tremendous advantages. The disadvantage is that she's tied to a record, a policy record, which is broadly unpopular in the United States. And she can easily be cast as a Bay Area progressive who needs to win middle of the road or independent or working class votes in places like central or rural Pennsylvania and Ohio. So,
but the fact is that the Democratic Party has rallied behind her, which suggests to me their huge desire to prevent Donald Trump.
Yeah, that means that she will be able to generate a great deal of enthusiasm that Joe Biden simply wasn't capable of generating.
Because Democrats believed that she could win, and they did not believe that Joe Biden could win.
I think a lot of Democrats said, are you asking me to cast a ballot for a man who is seems visibly in the early stages of dementia and who is lying to us about the state of his health? And I think a lot of Democrats simply weren't prepared to do that. They might not have voted for Trump, but they would have stayed home. Now, Harris has more than energized the base. I think there's genuine enthusiasm for her. The problem she has is this. The enthusiasm she's generating in California doesn't matter, right? She needs to win over voters who are deeply unsatisfied or dissatisfied with the state of their lives after 4 years of the administration she shared with Joe Biden. And so she has to find a way to convince those voters that she's going to make their lives better. And in the hands of a more capable opponent, if the Republicans had a capable opponent, I think she would have a very hard time doing it. Her super weapon, right? Her weapon of mass destruction is none other than Donald Trump, who seems intent on harming his own candidacy every opportunity he gets.
What is it about his DNA that makes him that way?
Well, I guess I'm not supposed to answer that he's crazy. So I don't know.
Well, you once said that the Republican ticket is crazy and reckless.
Well, it is. I mean, but you're asking me a more personal question, Charlie. One is a question about the, you know, kind of a metaphorical comment on on the temper and the ideology of this version of the Republican Party, a party that until 10 years ago I always voted for, or 8 years ago,
pre-Trump,
right? But you're asking me a question, a kind of a characterological question about Trump. Why can't he tone it down? Why can't he get off the election denialism?
Why can't he discipline himself?
Why can't he avoid, say, incredibly stupid things like commenting on Kamala Harris's racial identity? And I think it just goes to the guy he is. You know, Trump is in a weird way, there's an honesty. Apparently, there was a story that I think it was in The Times, which relates to a dinner he had in the last 10 days or so with some high-powered backers. I think Bill Ackman was among the people.
I can remind you of the time. I read the same piece. It was, I think, a dinner in East Hampton,
right,
with friends and fundraisers that he knew. And Bill Ackman, the New York financier, sat next to him. And I think it was reported by Jonathan Swan and Maggie Haberman.
That's right. So we're talking about the same story. And I think in that story, I don't have it in front of me, but he says something like, I am who I am.
Yeah.
And you know, that is, in that respect, give Trump points for honesty. He is not going to become a different kind of campaigner. He's not going to become any more disciplined. He has a certain kind of, I think, reptilian political genius. He understands things and hears things. Maybe the reptilian word is wrong, but he hears frequencies in American politics that are inaudible to many of us who are kind of, you know, so-called coastal elites.
And what is it that he hears that gives him this political rise?
he hears the rage of those who feel looked down upon and condescended to.
Because he's felt that?
Sorry?
Because he himself has felt that.
I suspect so. And those of us who sort of, or those people who say, well, you know, this is a guy who grew up in extraordinary wealth, mistake financial wealth for cultural status. I think what Trump has always felt he didn't have, what he yearned for, was a certain kind of cultural status. I'm told Richard Nixon felt much the same way about the kind of the Harvard elites who he since disdained him. You know, I wrote in a column a few weeks ago, I said, you know, Barack Obama understood in a single word what his political brand was, and that brand was hope. Trump understands it in a single word too, and it's defiance. And it's defiance of a social and cultural elite that in many respects he has rightly intuited has badly failed the country and done so while reaping most of the rewards and ceaselessly congratulating itself for its virtue. And Trump was able in a very canny and powerful way to capitalize on it because he never bent the knee to the political pieties of that class, right? He owned his crudeness. He owned his personality. He owned that kind of swaggering middle finger.
Yet he was for their approval and to be part of them.
Right. And then having not gotten it, this is almost a story from a Disney movie. You know, having failed to achieve or to gain the approval of the people from whom he desperately sought it, he turned to another audience. But, you know, one of the things I often say about Trump is that the secret of the demagogue is that isn't that they are totally wrong. It's that they're half right. And Trump was able to capitalize on a succession of half truths, which his supposed cultural or social betters were unable to see.
What's an example of that?
That immigration is a major problem in the United States. And that it is, or let me put it this way, because I'm a believer in legal immigration. I'm the son of legal immigrants from Mexico and Nazi, post-Nazi Europe. Illegal immigration on a massive scale was a force of both cultural and economic dislocation for millions of Americans whom we treated as service workers, people in manual industries, whom those of us in the kind of the writerly class treated with indifference or disdain. And what Trump understood from the beginning of his candidacy, I'm going back to 2015, was that the story of mass migration from the, you know, proverbial South to North was the most important political story of our time. It's why Brexit happened. It's why the politics of Europe have shifted so far to the right. It explains a lot of what is happening, not everything, but a lot of what is happening in the United States. And he seized on this as his signature issue. Now, were his solutions right? No. Was his rhetoric ugly? Yes. Do I want a Trumpian vision for what America should be? No, not at all. We are a land of immigrants. But he did understand that mass unchecked migration was a serious problem. And the Biden administration gave him an enormous opening to revive his political fortunes by mishandling the border crisis.
And why did they mishandle it?
You know, this is one of the great political mysteries of all time. And you can go back to accounts in the New York Times, news accounts, which show that within days of Biden taking office and reversing many of Trump's previous orders, the message was sent through the migrant community in Mexico or elsewhere in Latin America that America was open and they could start moving north. And there was very little desire, I think, in the Biden team to impose some of the harsh and ugly methods that Trump had imposed to prevent the mass flow of migration. I also think Biden was just not attentive, for whatever reasons, and they might have something to do with his mental state, was not attentive to the seriousness of the crisis. He kept relying on old thinking. At one point, I remember he said, well, this is just a seasonal thing. People come during the colder months and then they stop coming during the hotter months. Turned out it wasn't at all the case. And then you add to that a succession of socioeconomic and political breakdowns in Latin America of a kind that we really haven't seen, at least at that scale, in the past. And you have that kind of crisis. But I don't understand how it is that Biden kind of sat on his hands, didn't replace his Secretary of Homeland Security, didn't really take action until just a few months ago. And then when he did take action, the number of crossings or encounters at the border dropped dramatically, which showed that he could have done something. He could have taken action 2 or 3 years earlier. I just don't get it.
And the administration was willing to accept a compromise that was put together by a Republican and Democratic coalition.
Yeah, and that's an important point. There was good legislation that Senator Lankford of Oklahoma had cobbled together. Democrats and Republicans, a grand compromise, torpedoed cynically by Donald Trump and his minions in the Senate. But that still was late in the game. It was late last year, early this year. Biden could have taken executive action. You know, President Obama, who nobody thinks of as an abuser of human rights, didn't hesitate to use the executive mechanisms to deport illegal immigrants. And because I think he understood, as other presidents have, that Americans also believe that unchecked migration, that kind of lawlessness, is just insulting to the idea of the rule of law, irrespective of the question of the humanitarian needs of people coming across the border. So, you know, political mistakes often in hindsight appear to be inexplicable. They're driven by ideological factors, which are difficult to make sense of when you're outside an administration.
Is it unfair, even though politics is a place of unfairness, is it unfair to try to characterize the Democratic nominee as the czar of the border?
Well, I mean, you know, if you look at
Vice President and...
I mean, it was never exactly a congressionally mandated remit. I mean, if you look at the precise language, he was supposed to look at the causes of how this was happening, and the crises in the so-called Northern Triangle of Central America and elsewhere. But the vice presidential job is nothing if not a political job. And Harris had an opportunity both inside the administration and then in the broader public to press for a much tougher minded approach, which she didn't. She had, if you look back, she had an interview with Chuck Todd of NBC, in which she made the kind of risible statement that the border is secure. It didn't appear like she was paying a great deal of attention to it. She just wanted to make it go away. And again, this is a fair criticism of her vice presidency. She knew perfectly well, whether, you know, she was border czar or something not quite that, that she had a pedestal on which to advocate policy, and I don't think she ever did it.
She is now trying to, in terms of the kinds of commercials in support of her, suggesting that she was the attorney general and then the senator from a border state.
Yeah,
and that she was always in favor of enforcement.
My impression of Kamala Harris is that she is a unusually opportunistic politician in terms of where she stands ideologically. And I think that was true when she was DA in San Francisco tried to run up the record of convictions with a lot of drug possession, felony convictions, often of marijuana, things like that. And then went along with the drift in California politics towards decriminalization of many forms of offenses. In fact, my principal hope for Kamala Harris rests in the fact that she is not the ideological progressive that I fear she is, but in fact is just another run-of-the-mill opportunistic politician who's going to find her way towards politically popular positions which aren't too radical.
And you'll be pleased to make that judgment about her.
Yes. I mean, it's sort of a sad comment on American politics, whether, you know, I'd rather take a feckless opportunist than a committed radical.
Yeah. So in a sense, you had said you couldn't vote for Joe Biden. And you're not sure.
No, I'm not sure I did. I think I would have voted for Joe Biden if he were the candidate.
I understood you, and I could be wrong in terms of my recollection, but that you were not at a point in terms of your conversations with Gayle Collins to believe that you could vote for either. I mean, you've said you couldn't vote for Trump.
I'm never going to vote for Trump. I don't think I said, you know, listen, those conversations are fairly freewheeling and we have them every week. So sometimes I don't quite remember what it is that that we say in the spur of the moment. I think if Joe Biden were the nominee with a heavy heart and a lot of doubt, I would cast the lever for him because he has done enough as president that I think deserved my support, even if I didn't think he would have been able to serve out the entirety of a second term. In particular, the support for Ukraine, I think, is a pivot point in world history, and it's massively important. And of course, his support for Israel, at least in the early stages of the war, I feel like he surrounded himself with a foreign policy team, which I at least sometimes agree with. It's Harris who worries me. Harris worries me because I'm not sure whether she is a fierce progressive. And if she is, she will champion, you know, this is an interesting, sorry to cut myself off mid-thought, Charlie, but just thinking out loud, this is an interesting moment. And I think it's Andrew Sullivan who pointed this out. For certain kinds of never Trumpers like me, whose life was made considerably easier by the fact that in Hillary Clinton and Joe Biden, we had essentially centrist Democrats whom we could more or less get behind, right, without too much political or ideological discomfort. You know, I knew when I voted for Hillary or when I voted for Joe, taxes would go up, policies would be pursued that I didn't quite love, right, or even like.
And they believed in traditional liberalism in terms of foreign policy and the way the world works.
Right. And they were in the tradition of Obama and Clinton. And I could live with that. The real challenge comes when I'm confronted with a much purer type of progressive in Kamala Harris, who subscribes to certain kinds of views that are really inimical to my perspective. And that makes it a much tougher choice.
And what's the most glaring of those views in the foreign policy realm?
Well, it's difficult to say what exactly she thinks, but the noises that Kamala Harris has made about the conflict in the Middle East, just take one example, alarm me. She has clearly staked a position to the left of President Biden and Tony Blinken, expressed sympathy for protests on campus, which I consider profoundly inflected by an anti-Zionism that is indistinguishable from anti-Semitism. At least 4 years ago, she was calling for massive reductions in the defense budget at a time when Russia, China, and Iran are becoming very serious competitors on the global stage, more than competitors, enemies on the global stage. I don't have any sense of a foreign policy of hers, other than, of course, her sort of nonfeasance on the border these last few years. She seems to be behind support for Ukraine, which I think is a good thing. But I also worry that, you know, early missteps in her administration, signals of weakness to a Vladimir Putin or to a Xi Jinping, are going to invite aggression and provocation on their part. There's one area where I agree with Donald Trump, not that he needed to say it for me to think this, but I think the world is teetering on the close to a global catastrophe. I think if you look at the combination of what is happening in Ukraine, the Middle East, the South China Sea, we are seeing a series of regional crises rising and rising and rising, and eventually they're going to overspill their borders and become a single world crisis.
I was going to suggest what you also see is an axis of China, Russia, North Korea, and Iran.
Exactly. What I call an axis of aggression. And, you know, if you look at the history of the 1930s, there was no natural alliance between Germany and Italy. Italy had spent most of the First World War fighting the Central Powers. Japan was an ally of Britain. These countries found themselves because they found a common enemy in the what they perceived to be the weak and weak-willed Western democracies. And so eventually you had the alliance between Hitler and Mussolini, and that expanded to an alliance with Japan. And actually for 2 years, it was an alliance with Joseph Stalin as well, until Hitler turned on Stalin. So now fast forward more than 80 years, and what used to be a rivalry between Russia and China has become a pact of limitless friendship. Iran supplies Russia with drones it needs to strike Ukraine. Increasingly, the Russians are promising advanced munitions to the Iranians. The Chinese and the Iranians have struck a $200 billion strategic partnership. This is becoming an axis. It's hard to look at it any other way. And this is North Korea, I might add, is helping the Russians out in Ukraine. This is a partnership, and it's a partnership of authoritarian states that are bent on destroying the Western democracies that happen to be in their regional orbits, whether it's Taiwan, Ukraine, or Israel. And I don't know whether we would have in a President Harris or Harris-Walz administration a kind of a sense of the historical moment. And one of the reasons, again, why I think Biden was not, did the right thing in Ukraine and then with Israel is because I think a man born in 1942 had the historical imagination, understanding about how these global conflicts play out. And I'm worried that there's a kind of there's a lack of that understanding. Now, if we were to turn this conversation to Trump, I worry about that too. It's why I could never vote for them.
And so are the NATO countries. I mean, what we're talking about is what is it that we're looking for in the next president in terms, as you wrote, America's primacy.
Right. And in both places, you have two tickets that seem to have deep doubts about the value of that primacy. It's coming in different directions, but, you know, there's an expression in French about the way in which the extremes touch. And you have a kind of progressive doubts. And then you have the J.D. Vance view, which is the whole rest of the world can go hang itself. He only cares about one foreign policy, which is our foreign policy at the Rio Grande. Now, one point that's worth noting is that Trump's foreign policy, in certain respects, in practice, was better than the foreign policy in rhetoric. So Trump, for example, rhetorically cozied up to Vladimir Putin. But if you actually look at Trump administration policy with Ukraine, Trump did more to prepare the Ukrainians for the eventual onslaught than the Obama administration had in the preceding 8 years, or the Obama-Biden administration, which in practice was a very weak-kneed policy. So people who I think many supporters or ambivalent supporters of Trump say, yeah, the rhetoric is terrible, but no, in the end, he didn't pull us out of NATO. It was just his way of jawboning European states into spending more on their defense, which in fact, they are finally doing. My fear about the Trump administration is that Trump 2.0 is going to mean it this time, is going to be staffed up with MAGAite ideologues rather than traditional Republicans, and is going to actually execute the policy he claims to want. And that is a terrifying fear, because that kind of America is a sort of Charles Lindbergh version of what the United States should be.
America first.
Correct.
The interesting thing is we don't know, I don't think, exactly where the Democratic nominee stands on the questions you raise.
Yeah.
We know where Joe Biden stood, even though there's obviously criticism of Joe Biden for the withdrawal from Afghanistan in terms of the way it was executed. There is a criticism of Joe Biden for the slowness of some of the response to the Russian invasion of Ukraine. When I think about it, there's a lot of admiration for him, is how he put together, once he was committed, to not only Israel, but also Ukraine. Those were diplomatic skills that he brought to the White House.
Yeah, and as I said, not just a diplomatic skills, but very importantly, historical imagination. If you can't think in terms of historical references, you are going to make mistakes as a president, fundamental mistakes. Of course, it's not enough to just understand history. It's also important to understand it correctly. But I think Biden brought all of that. And at its best, the Biden legacy is going to be remembered well. You know, AUKUS, for instance, the treaty with or the deal with the Australians and the UK to start giving Australia some serious military kit is a historic agreement. Strengthening ties, military ties with Japan, strengthening ties between Japan and South Korea, which is something that Rahm Emanuel, our very gifted ambassador, former mayor of Chicago, was able to do. These are important legacies.
Chief of staff for Barack Obama.
A singular force of nature in politics and all spheres of life, I should say. And of course, organizing a defense of Ukraine that has allowed Ukraine to remain free. The problem that Biden has, I think, is that he doesn't seem to have a concept of victory. He's like, if he were a Union general, he would be George Meade. You know, and I mean this sort of with respect to Meade's legacy as the victor of Gettysburg, who didn't have the wit to pursue his enemy when the enemy was defeated and on the run. And in some sense, this almost gives me an idea for a column. This is like the Meade administration, which is, you know, Meade said, well, told Lincoln, well, I've repelled the invader from our soil. And Lincoln's response was, it's all our soil, right? You know, Biden seems to think that it's enough that the Ukrainians managed, at least for a time, to fight the Russians to a draw. When he supports Israel, it's always with defensive weaponry. But the point of offense is it's essentially an extension of a form of defense, at least if the team is fundamentally being assaulted by its enemy. And I don't think he quite got that. But I'm grateful for the ways in which he's been more than half right.
But he's also China. I mean, he understands, most people believe that the 21st century is about the U.S. versus China. And he understood that in terms of China aggression, many will argue, and has built the relationship with those countries threatened by China.
Absolutely. And that includes Vietnam. It includes restoring a relationship with the Philippines. With the Philippines, we got lucky in that we got the return of a more normal sane government, if I may say, than we had under the Duterte, the cruel Duterte regime. So he's been in that sense, he's been fortunate. But yes, he's had a geostrategic vision. And that comes from being able to look at maps and understand that. I'm not sure, by the way, that the great story of the 21st century is going to be the United States versus China.
What do you think it is going to be?
Well, I don't know. You know, as Niels Bohr, the great Danish Jewish physicist, said, prediction is very difficult, especially about the future.
Yes.
But, you know, 20 years ago, we thought the fundamental conflict in the world was going to be the West against terrorist groups. And now it's China. And 20 years from now, it might be something completely different. I do think it's going to be this. I think the great question, both domestically and internationally, in our time, and really over the past more than 100 years, is the struggle between liberalism and illiberalism. We used to talk about American politics as liberals versus conservatives.
Let me interrupt you before you continue. Yeah. Define those two terms for all of us.
Okay, so liberalism is a fundamentally political, but also a social and a moral concept that places the liberty of the individual person, his or her conscience and reasonable freedom of action. That is to say, as you know, Mill said, the right to extend your arm to just before the nose of the next person, right? And liberalism is the political system that holds the needs of the individual at the center of its legal and political institutional infrastructure, right?
Yes.
So the Bill of Rights, limits on government, the ability for people to go places, marry people, think things, say things, and do things as they see fit. Again, with that principle, so long as it doesn't impinge on the right of your neighbor to do the same. That's at the heart of the liberalism, I mean, okay? And for an illiberalism is any set of ideologies which do not hold the individual place the individual at the center of its political and social concerns. It can be certain types of communitarianism, communism, socialism, nationalism is illiberalism. Any political system that extols something above the individual, right? The nation above the individual, the commune above the individual, whatever it is, all of those are illiberal political orders. And there's illiberalism that is of a left-wing variety, and there's illiberalism of a right-wing variety. But in illiberal systems, the individual is not the most important consideration. And if you look at American politics up until 10 or 20 years, at least 10 years ago, you know, what we called conservative was just a type of liberalism, right? George W. Bush never seriously questioned the right of the press to examine the conduct of his administration. You know, they had fights at the margins, but George W. Bush, in that sense, was a classic liberal, as was Ronald Reagan. You know, name almost any Republican president you can think of, and even if they quarreled at the margins, they belonged to the liberal worldview. But with the advent of Trump and Trumpism in the United States and other, you know, far right parties in Europe, you suddenly have an illiberal movement. You know, you heard J.D. Vance speak at the convention, and basically he said, the Constitution is important, rights are important, the idea of America is important, but it's not as important as the soil in which my children will bury me in the hills of Ohio or Kentucky. That's nationalism. That's illiberalism. And it's the moment he said that, I said to myself, I will never vote for these guys. They don't believe in the America I believe in. Do you believe in America as a place fundamentally or as an ideal? Look, I like the Grand Canyon, But what matters to me is life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Do you believe that most of the MAGA supporters of Donald Trump have accepted illiberalism, or they simply have a grievance in terms of how they think it has affected their lives?
I think it's mostly the latter. I think the MAGA movement is anger in search of an idea.
Does it match the illiberalism in Europe? Does it match the illiberalism in Hungary? Does
yes.
it match the illiberalism in Russia? Does it?
Well, I don't know about Russia, but certainly in Hungary. And you heard Donald Trump, I think, in his...
Or in Sweden or in other places that have had recent elections. The support for Le Pen.
And... Well, the Penist movement, I think it has a lot in common with. What's Tolstoy's line? Unhappy families are unhappy in their own ways. Like, right-wing parties are right-wing in their own ways. But you heard Donald Trump speak in glowing terms about Viktor Orban in Hungary, who has set himself up as a kind of a populist autocrat with very little tolerance. And that's the spirit of this thing. Can I just get back to the original point, just very briefly?
Please do, please.
So we see this playing out in a kind of a microcosm in the United States. And I don't want to put Donald Trump in the same camp as Vladimir Putin or Xi Jinping. I mean, at the end of the day, there's a reason he's not president. For all of what happened on January 6th, he was ultimately ended up against his will ceding power in the way that Putin never would, or Erdogan or Maduro never would. So he's not at that level. But the illiberalism that you see in China, Russia, Iran, all of these places put something else above the question of individual rights and conscience. Mm-hmm. And that is our collective enemy. And that is going to be the defining struggle of the 21st century, quite frankly, as it was of the 20th, whether we were fighting communism or fascism.
My question to you is, would Donald Trump have given up power if he could have resisted the transfer of power?
I suspect not, but the fortunate...
What does that say about him?
Oh, he's an awful, awful, disgraceful human being who should not be allowed to be, who should not be close to power. But it also says that American democratic institutions are much stronger than some of us warriors feared they might be. We're not Yeltsin's Russia, teetering at the edge of a new despotism. We're not Weimar Germany. We are 248 years old. And it was important, Charlie, that it was Trump's federal judges who turned back suit after suit. It was Trump's Supreme Court, largely Trump's Supreme Court, that dismissed some of his election claims. It was Republican officials like Brad Raffensperger Secretary of State in Georgia, right, who turned back his demands for the election. Brian Kemp
and recorded a phone call from the president.
And it was Mark Milley, you know, as tough a general as you can imagine, right, who did everything he could lawfully to make sure that the president couldn't engineer any kind of coup or crisis at the end of his presidency.
So this question, go ahead.
All I'm saying is America is a more deeply democratic nation than some of us or some people worry that it might be. Our roots are deep.
So you accept the democratic argument that Donald Trump is a threat to democracy.
I think Donald Trump wants to be or could be a threat to democracy, but I don't think he would be able. And maybe I'm being flippant, okay? I mean, believe me, I wake up on Mondays, Wednesdays, Fridays, and Sundays and think, this guy's the worst. And then on the alternate days, I'm like, she's the worst. And so far, all I can say is I won't vote. I definitely won't vote for Trump. I probably won't vote for her. But what I'm saying is that Trump, as ill-intentioned as he is, as malign as he is merely the president. And years ago, I had a conversation with another sitting president, a much more thoughtful man. I won't say who it is, but a much more thoughtful man than he's given credit for being. And he spent some minutes musing on just how limited the power of the presidency really is.
I'm guessing George W. Bush.
Well, I'm not saying, but it could be. He'd be one former president.
Yes, yes. I've often wondered this. Where are you in terms of libertarians?
I've never been a libertarian. I think libertarianism misunderstands important parts of human nature.
Which is what?
Which is that we are much more fallible and vulnerable and weak than libertarianism would have us be. And I say this with respect for libertarians because the fundamental impulse, let's maximize liberty, including, for instance, on, you know, hard drug use, to take one example. I admire them in principle. I just think that in practice, things fail. And I'll just give you an example. I remember once sitting next to someone who knew who I was, and it turned out that this person was, I think she was on the board of Cato, but she was a very committed libertarian. And we suddenly the subject of drug legalization came up. And I said, you know, I could never be in favor of it. I think it's a terrible idea. And she kind of looked at me with, you know, like she was sitting next to the biggest idiot in the world. And you listen to libertarians who were so in favor of decriminalization of hard drugs in Oregon. That has turned into a catastrophe in Oregon. Oregon, Portland in particular, became a magnet for every fentanyl and meth user. The quality of city life declined dramatically. Services weren't available. And this is a nice illustration for me. I don't mean a nice, but an apt illustration for me of how what sounds like a great idea in theory completely breaks down in practice because the goal of drug users is to get high. And destructive behavior is part and parcel of that, destructive to themselves and destructive to those whom they love. So I've never, among many other reasons, never found myself sympathetic to libertarianism because I think it's a cartoon view of what human nature is about.
What does Kamala Harris have to do to convince you to vote for her?
Well, you know, I wrote a column about this just this week. I would like to hear a serious articulation of a foreign policy that matches the moment.
Right.
Including in terms of an immigration policy. I would like to hear a ringing affirmation of the benefits of a free market system buttressed by social protection. I understand she's a Democrat. I get it. I don't mind it. But I would like to hear a statement that the basis of this country is freedom and equality, not freedom and equity. That's another aspect that concerns me about at least shades of her politics in the past.
Equality rather than equity.
Right. Essentially, equality of outcomes rather than equality of opportunities. You know, I'm not asking for Kamala Harris, with whom I agree on 90, 80, 70, I don't know, not even 50%. But I want to make sure that on some baseline convictions, she and I are on the same team. And in that case, I'll gladly vote for her. We haven't heard that from her yet. She's given no real interviews. Her positions have been all over the map over the years. I don't mind a liberal presidency. This country has survived and sometimes flourished under liberal presidencies, but I really would mind a progressive, hard left-wing presidency. I think that would be really damaging to us.
But it seems to me, in terms of reading a lot of what you have written, you know, that you are strongly emphasizing that whoever is president has to accept America's role in the world and be prepared to defend it.
You know, after 1945, when Britain was exhausted, it was able, to everyone's great good luck, to turn to a United States, which had been chastened by its own post-World War I experience of isolationism, and was ready to assume the mantle of leadership for the free world. Not always entirely free, leadership not always entirely competent, but it saw us through a uniquely dangerous period without a Third World War, and allowed us to defeat the most monstrous regimes in history, the Stalinist regime and then the Maoist regime, without a catastrophe. And we're moving into a similar kind of world. I am a child of someone, I'm the grandson of someone who fled the Bolsheviks. My great-grandfather vanished into the Lubyanka prison, never to be heard from again. I'm the child of a mother who was hidden during the Second World War from the Nazis. Like, these are not, these volcanoes aren't dormant for me. So, you know, if you'll take that, they're real, they're explosive. And we are in a period where something similar is happening, where I think incompetence or inadvertence or inattention by an American administration could allow that kind of world where my ancestors were permanent refugees and exiles, that kind of world to restart, to resume.
Do you believe that the media is doing its job to educate on that choice?
Media is a plural noun. I think there's some amazing, fantastic reporting too. That, you know, I mean, if the media is Charlie Rose and David Sanger and, you know, journalists, I have, you know, immense respect for, yes, it's doing its job. But, you know, the failure is not a media failure. Ultimately, the failure is a national one. The percentage of Americans who actually consume serious news aren't getting their impressions of the world from TikTok or other forms of social media. It's a dwindling percentage of Americans. And, you know, part of democracy is a sense of responsibility for our own national destiny, which requires information. And too many people just choose not to get it. So this is not a media problem. It's an America problem.
I want to turn to foreign policy in terms of Israel and the war in Gaza and what's going on. But one quick question. Who's ahead right now?
Harris.
Harris.
I think so.
On the last New York Times poll, in terms of having a 4-point lead in the three battleground states.
Yeah, and that's reversible. But Harris also has momentum, and Trump not only seems to have stalled out, he doesn't seem to have an idea of how to regain momentum. But as you know, when we began this conversation, Charlie, we were talking about the revolutions in political fortunes. And so it's, could there be other revolutions? I would be astounded if there aren't.
Yeah, it would be hard not to believe that's possible if you just look at what's happened in the last 4 weeks.
Right, exactly.
Israel. Where are we in terms of getting a ceasefire and bringing the hostages home?
Well, that's, again, an impossible question to answer because a ceasefire has been declared imminent now for months. One problem that we have is that we have in... before I say what I was about to say...
Yes.
The overriding problem is that you have an Iranian regime with proxies in Lebanon, Gaza, the West Bank, and Yemen, and other places, Iraq, that wants to wipe the Jewish state off the map. and eliminate most, if not all, of its people. That is the foundational problem, the regime in Iran. That's the strategic problem that not only the Israelis face, but the Americans face.
And you wrote a column calling it the five wars that Israel faces.
Right, exactly. But at a smaller level, the problem you have is an Israeli government that's talking out of two sides of its mouth. It is saying on the one hand that it wants a ceasefire, which would essentially end the war on some terms or other, redeem the hostages. And the same government on alternative days of the week or alternate days of the week, putting on its total victory hat, literally a hat that Netanyahu had made for him, saying that Israel is going to fight this war until every last Hamas fighter is killed or surrenders. And those two are not, there's no squaring of that circle. And so it's very difficult to see where the war is, because you have a government in Israel that is pursuing, I think, a deliberately ambiguous, if not to say dishonest, policy of not declaring what its goals are. And that's a real failure of leadership.
Is it also a reflection of the fact that the prime minister is hostage to the politics of Israel and what keeps him in power?
That's precisely right. But above all, the second half of that statement, what keeps him in power? I think the prime minister understands that October 7th will be a blot on his biography that will be remembered in 500 years. In 500 years, Jews will be around and they'll say, what do we remember about King Netanyahu? And they'll say, the greatest catastrophe in Jewish life since the Holocaust. That's what we'll remember. And I think he is desperate at his age to find a way out of that being his capstone, his legacy. So he is, for, it seems to me, for his own political reasons, reasons of personal reputation and political survival, playing with the fortunes of Israel. And I think that is disgraceful leadership. And by the way, Charlie, that I don't think Israel has a bigger champion in mainstream media than I do. But you have to call it like
I do know that. And that's why I want you to speak to these issues that bother a lot of people.
And it's important to be able to distinguish Israel's cause, which is fighting totalitarian enemies bent on its annihilation, literally bent on its annihilation, and the fortunes of the prime minister who happened to be in power when this crisis began. It's important to be able to make that distinction, that you can be sternly critical of the policy of the government and at the same time support Israel's right to have well-defended, sound borders and a secure life in its national home.
What's the chance that this prime minister will lose power?
Well, this is a terrible question, Charlie, because people have been suspecting that Bibi was right on his way out, at least, well, going back to the 1990s during his first stint in office. And certainly on numerous periods since at least 2018, when indictments started to be handed or investigations and indictments started to go out against him. He is a very, very canny political operative who has the good fortune of having had, with one important exception, no worthy political rival. The only important exception is Naftali Bennett, who is a center-right, used to be further-right, but a center-right figure who is nonetheless able to make himself credible with Israelis of the secular center, even secular left, and has proved that.
And so what is Naftali Bennett saying today about what he would do if he was prime minister?
Well, for that, you're going to have to read my column coming out later this week.
you know,
I interviewed Bennett at length last week when he was in New York, and that's I don't want to give my column away.
There are certain indications in terms of what you have written that I suspect we could determine what Naftali might be saying.
I think the important point is that Israel is maintaining a war in Gaza, but it's happening at a sort of a very slow burn. Maybe that's a bad metaphor, but the Israelis are really not moving in Gaza. What they need to do is mobilize.
Not moving in Gaza means what?
Meaning Israel's forces are 5% of Israel's forces are in Gaza. They are more or less conducting targeted raids. They have troops in certain places, but Hamas is finding opportunities to regroup. They're not being smashed. I'm talking about Hamas, and certainly not the Palestinians. And they should be in a week or 2 weeks, and then end the war and negotiate with Emiratis and Saudis and Egyptians to create an Arab security force. Let all those European countries like the Norwegians and Spaniards and Irish who have unilaterally recognized a Palestinian state to foot the bill for reconstruction. I'm not opposed to that. Be a good idea.
How about other Arab countries?
Well, Arab countries are notoriously parsimonious on those when it comes to that.
Well, but if in fact Saudi Arabia made some kind of agreement with Israel, which some say was one of the reasons why October 7th took place when it did, that Hamas feared that there was coming up some deal between Saudi Arabia and Israel?
October 7th was planned long before, had been in the works for a long time, but I think the timing had more to do with the 50th anniversary of the Yom Kippur War than anything else. But your point on the larger point here is I think there should be a division of labor for a post-Hamas Gaza. I think Arab states should take the lead in establishing some baseline measures of security, because the anarchy you have there is itself a humanitarian crisis. There's going to be a long-term reconstruction project, which should be funded by Europeans, USAID, you know, the usual reconstruction agencies, provided the money isn't diverted into rebuilding the tunnel infrastructure. And hopefully a successful experience in Gaza over time can show that a Palestinian state can more closely resemble the United Arab Emirates than, say, Yemen.
Do I hear you opposed to a Palestinian state at the present time?
Yes, but I'm in favor of a Palestinian state. I mean, I've said this before. A Palestinian state is necessary for the fulfillment of Zionism, and I am a Zionist. What do I mean by that? The purpose of Zionism is for Jews to neither be ruled by others nor rule over others. It is self-determination, right? And right now, Israel only has half of that because too many Palestinians have important aspects of their lives ruled over by the Israelis. Now, there are reasons for that. It didn't just happen by caprice or the cruelty of Israelis. But ultimately, what both Palestinians and Israelis deserve is a separation into two states. The great question is whether a Palestinian state is going to resemble Gaza before October 7th, a gigantic terrorist fortress aimed at destroying its neighbor. Or is it going to resemble a place like Costa Rica or the UAE, a place that is dedicated to improving the everyday life of its people? And I want that. But it's going to take time to create internal political, social, and cultural conditions where Palestinians say we are more interested in building a small but beautiful state of our own than we are in this historical fantasy that we're going to destroy the so-called Zionist regime and recoup orange groves in Jaffa.
Are there Palestinian organizations that should be in power in Gaza today?
Well, there aren't, I don't know if there's organizational structures because Hamas is a tyrannical regime that brutally stamps out any hint of opposition. And so none of those organizations could have possibly taken root. Hamas's treatment of its own people is a horror. But those organizations could take root. Those organizations could flourish. There are a lot of Palestinians either in Gaza, the West Bank, or the Palestinian diaspora, who I think could be very credible future leaders of a Palestinian state that wants the uplifting of its own people, but not at the expense of its neighbors. And that's the challenge. It's not the territorial shape of a Palestinian state. It is the character of that state. Is it going to be moderate and modernizing, or is it going to be radical and fundamentalist?
And what if Barghouti came out of prison as a potential leader?
I don't think Barghouti is Mandela. I was living in Israel when he
was. Palestinians do, or some of them do.
Yeah, but Mandela was a unique character who came out of prison committed to the idea of a racially harmonious South Africa that made wanted a better order for itself. He was not a revenge-seeking politician, and that was why we recall Mandela as a giant of 20th century statesmanship. He wasn't quite that, by the way, when he went into prison, but when he came out of prison, he came out fundamentally a great man and gave South Africa a chance, which sadly is being squandered, to be a prosperous state. I don't know if Barghouti is that. I've never conducted a prison interview with Barghouti, but the idea that, oh, he's the Palestinian Mandela deserves examination.
As you know, there have been loss of Palestinian lives who are not Hamas that has caused worldwide criticism of Israel. And lots of Palestinians have died. Have you criticized, and do you believe the idea should be criticized for its tactics in the war?
No. And since I'm going to get into trouble with that answer, let me spell out what I mean. Point one, every civilian death in war is a tragedy. There is no war in history, including the most righteous wars in history, that have not involved massive civilian deaths. We just commemorated D-Day, which we consider a glorious episode in the history of human freedom, but north of 20,000 French citizens were killed in Allied bombardments of Normandy on the eve of that invasion. So some historical context is required. These tragedies are sadly an inevitable part of war, and this was a war that was started brutally by Hamas. The second point is that Hamas is ultimately responsible for every death in this war, not only for initiating the conflict and initiating it in the way that it did, but for fighting behind, between, and beneath their own civilian population. All of that is a war crime. You know, recently we had this case of Israeli bombs hitting near a school, but no one seems to be asking, why is Hamas emplacing its command outposts in schools and mosques and hospitals and other civilian infrastructure? That's the war crime, not the Israelis attempting to destroy those who would seek to destroy Israel. The third aspect is this, which is, historically, urban combat is the most brutal kind of combat for obvious reasons. By even Hamas's, or by most measures, the ratio of civilian to Hamas casualties in Gaza is about 1-1. In most other urban conflicts, it's 9-1, 9 civilians to 1 military or militant combatant. Look at what the United States did in tandem with our Iraqi partners in Mosul just in 2016, 2017 under President Obama and then President Trump to flush ISIS out of the territory. It was a complete destruction of Mosul. So my point is Israel should be judged in comparison to other law-abiding Western democracies operating in similar kinds of threat environments. And I think by that token, the Israelis measure up very well.
What's the risk of a regional war?
Look, from a geographic standpoint, that's happening now. And the question is, how much worse can it get? And my sense is it can get a great deal worse very, very fast. For a number of reasons. First of all, there's almost a kind of a World War I logic. If you know the early history of the First World War, you know, the Austrians declare war on Serbia because of the killing of the Crown Prince, then the Russians come in for the Serbs, then the Germans come in for the Austrians, and the next thing you know, because some guy got killed in Sarajevo, German troops are marching into Paris.
And then we have war, exactly.
And then you have World War, and then the Brits get, you know, and so forth and so on. And now you have something potentially similar in which the Israelis fighting Hamas in Gaza brought in Hezbollah, which brings in Iran, which potentially brings in the Russians, the United States gets involved and so on. That's happening. It's a question of the intensity of it. And a factor which it hasn't been remarked on is that you now have a situation in which the countries at stake have as much an interest in escalating first than they do in de-escalating. Now, the Israeli calculation is that whenever Israel has struck first, as it did in 1967, and had first mover advantage, it was able to win its war swiftly. When it did not have that, like in 1973 or again in 2023, it had disastrous wars. So the Israelis, there's always been a side of the Israelis, which of the Israeli military complex that says we should strike first and we should strike very, very hard. That gives us an advantage. The Iranians and Hezbollah also have felt that way. That was the thinking behind with their Palestinian allies behind October 7th. And what Hezbollah seems to want to do in northern Israel, which is essentially conquer northern Israel without putting troops across. So this combination of geographies and ideas about advantage overlaid with ideology and questions of national prestige, all of these are coming together like atoms super colliding in a core. And I don't see how this doesn't become, to keep the metaphor going, super critical at any moment.
And Iran is weeks away from a nuclear weapon if it wants one?
Well, that's hard to say. Iran is weeks away from having the quantities it requires of highly enriched uranium that could be turned into a bomb. But how quickly can they weaponize it? And can they weaponize it in a package that's small enough to be delivered on top of a ballistic missile? And those are questions which become very difficult to answer because it's very easy to calculate the rate of Iranian enrichment. It's much more difficult to calculate. It's much more difficult to calculate how quickly they can assemble a weapon.
Bret Stephens, thank you so much.
Charlie, thank you. It's always an honor to be on your show.
Thank you so much.